please state your name for the audience?
Jesse Zenz.
Heidi Zenz.
Aha. So you know each other then?
Perhaps.
Are you related in any way?
We are now.
You're related by wristwatches? How long have you been married, Kurt?
5 days.
5 days, you say? And yet, you're in the bunker with a creepy Scottish guy. What?
Because you're in our house every evening.
Ah. Oh, you're those people. I didn't know you knew about that. Me and the elves like to come in and mend your shoes. Anyway, where are you from?
St. Paul, Minnesota.
Right. Did you have to check with them?
She's the boss.
Yeah, no, you're playing this very well. The only thing that surprises me that you're married, yet you were sitting in lesbian row, and you were not. I've uncovered this. There are genuine lesbians that visit this show. And they want to sit in lesbian row, and that seat was taken up by a heterosexual married woman. I like your style, kids. Anyway, I wish you all the best. How long? What, you came to LA for your honeymoon?
Yes.
It's surprisingly not like the TV show Entourage, isn't it? Did you meet the robot?
Not yet.
Say hi.
Hey.
It's Jeff.
Hi, Jeff.
Yeah. Congratulations, kids. What do you think, Jeff?
Top show, Ferguson.
Thanks, buddy. It's gonna be a good show.
The Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson.
Great, oh, I can hardly hear myself over your completely real applause and cheering, which is overwhelming. It's genuine, it's like doing Oprah's last show. Except we've got 20,000 less people and a middle-aged white dude. But never mind, because I like the studio audience, they're very attractive. They are very, very attractive. A couple of them are not attractive. And they know who they are. But most of them are very attractive. Which means it's a great day for America, everybody. Yes, yes. It is. It's a great day for America. But, again, not a great day for former California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. Sources say that Arnold is laying low at his home in Idaho, which is over there. He's alone in the mountains, just him and a few of his closest secret families. And he's only... he's only been in Idaho for a day, and already the potatoes are pregnant. CIA is going back to Pakistan for yet another search of Osama bin Laden's compound. And I'm like, oh, come on, guys. If you want porn, get off the internet like everybody else. You join the American Idol, I love it. The ex-American Idol judge, Cara Diogara, says that... You want me to remember your name, you stay more than one season, biatch. Anyway, Cara Diogara said... No, she announced that she got high on pot brownies at Paula Abdul's house. She said at one point she was so high that Paula started to make sense. Live to death. Anyway, of course, it's a great day for Scotty McCreery, the new winner of the American Idol. Congratulations, Scotty. If you haven't seen Scotty, he's a country singer with a really deep voice. He's very young, though. Do you got a picture of Scotty? There he is. The ladies loved Scotty. The female voters went cock-a-hoop over Scotty's... Scotty's cute southern charm and his accent and loveliness. But remember, don't forget, girls, you felt the same way about Clay Aitken. You remember that? Yeah. Remember how that turned out? Don't worry, though, ladies. You've still got Ricky Martin. He's your... He knows how to treat a woman to lunch. Both of the finalists in American Idol are country singers, and I like that, because whenever I was watching American Idol, they're always going, that doesn't sound like singing, that sounds like falling down a well. But I like Scotty McCreery. The kid's a traditional country singer. People describe him as a mini Randy Travis. So that's how I pronounce it. Randy Travis, yeah. He's like a mini Randy Travis. My favorite country singer was Johnny Cash. We wouldn't have to have a mini Johnny Cash around, would we? Oh.
I walk the line, bitches.
I'm not sure how I feel about that, actually. And I've always been a fan of the country music. It's very popular in Scotland because it resonates with Scottish people. You know, the getting drunk, getting your heart broke, getting drunken again, and the kicking and the gouging and the mud and the blood and the beer. And people talk about, you know, rap music is violent, but country music is very violent. The great Johnny Cash sang a song about shooting a guy just to watch him die, and Carrie Underwood had beat the crap out of her boyfriend's car. And then the guy that sang, take this job and shove it, and I've got a pretty good idea where he wanted it shoved as well. And both of the American Idol finalists are going to Nashville to record a country album. I love Nashville. I do. It's a great town. I taped my last comedy special there. And I wanted to do it there because the crowds are great and because I wanted to ride a bull. So I did. I rode that bad boy a lot longer than I thought I could. And then I left my hotel room and went out to record my stand-up program. You know, I can wait. I got nothing else to do. When I was in Nashville, though, I really wanted a cowboy hat. So I found a hat store, and I bought a snakeskin hat. Don't send me letters, PETA. It was artificial snakeskin. I like, you know, it was fake. I like my cowboy hats like I like my boobies. I like them big and fake and pushed down over my eyes. That's how I want them. I like country music because it's so American, you know. And I mean, music is an international language, of course, but country music doesn't sound right coming from other places. I mean, it doesn't sound like, Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. It doesn't mean all country music is good, though. I mean, like any other music, there's plenty of it that's not so good. I tend to like the outlaws of country music, you know, big, tough dudes that can kick your ass, like Toby Keith or Trace Atkins or Katie Lang. You know, the big. Lesbian Rose, like, hey, wait a minute. Wait a minute. What did you say about Katie? It was a joke, lesbians, a joke. Anyway, I don't like it when Hollywood people try to be country artists. You know, when I think authentic and soul of the earth, the first name that comes to my mind is not, in fact, Gwyneth Paltrow. Now, I've got nothing against Gwyneth Paltrow. She's got nice skin and pretty hair. need to hear the country music. No, no. My limo's in the shop. My husband's Chris Martin. I'll make a record because Coldplay sounds like kitties farting. Just be grateful I'm not a songwriter, all right? Do you know who became a country singer? Hootie. Hootie from Hootie and the Blowfish. I don't know what happened to the Blowfish. I think Hootie set them free into the ocean. Set them free where they earn money doing what Blowfish do. It's my new thing, I'm trying. It's that look that says, I know how to treat a woman to lunch. Anyway, commercial break time, is it?
You said it, Mr. Ferguson.
I did. I said it was commercial break time.
Yes, you did.
Yeah. Why are you talking like that, trying to be all sexy tonight?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, you're doing your sexy voice. I think you're making sort of moves at this very attractive audience. I can see you trying to work them.
Hey. Hey there, hey, how are you?
Yeah. Jeff, you're gay and that's lesbian row. This is never gonna work.
Awkward.
Yeah, a little bit. All right, we'll take a break. We'll be right back, everybody. We'll be right back. To the show with the biggest effects in late night. Top that, you bony bastard.
Bulls.
Yeah, right. What time is it, Jeffrey Peterson?
Good night, sweetheart. Well, it's time to go. Boo, 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 boo.
I thought that was Gwyneth Paltrow there for a minute.
In your pants.
Hey! Play the twiddly thing, will you?
Twitter is the thing with all the bleeds.
All right, this is from Michael in Fort Worth in Texas, who says, Dear Craig, is it ever a good idea to tell your wife you think her family is crazy? Yeah, but wait until she's drunk and angry. And in Texas. This is from Samantha in Tacoma in Washington. Hey, Craig, my friends are all going to your show this weekend up here. Oh, yeah, I'm playing at Seattle on Sunday. Book early to avoid disappointment. And also for the show. Are you coming with me to Seattle this weekend?
No, I have a place there, though.
You got a place in Seattle?
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
Yeah, you should come by while you're there.
Well, I am going to be there. Where in Seattle is your place, and what do you do there?
Oh, it's in the upper portion.
Yeah. Upper portion of Seattle.
Yeah, the upper part.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah. I'll be at the lower part, so.
Oh, too bad.
Yeah. Anyway, Samantha says, my friends and I are going to be at your show this weekend up here. We're wondering if you want to meet us for coffee afterwards at Top Pot Donuts. Have I just been hijacked by some donut store for a commercial? I'll see you there. Top Pot Donuts. You ever go to Top Pot Donuts when you're in Seattle?
Oh, yeah, all the time.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I know Jerry, the owner, great guy.
Jerry, yeah. All right, then. This is from Christian in Trondheim, Norway. Hey, you know who was from Trondheim? Aha! Aha, you know, take on me, take on me.
me, take me out. They call me Albedo.
You remember that one, right?
Yeah.
That was great. They had another great song. It was called The Sun Always Shines on TV. Touch me. The sun always shines on TV. It probably makes more sense in Norwegian. And if the sun always shines on TV, then what happened in here? Am I right, Jeff? Am I right?
You said it, girlfriend.
Right. Anyway, Christian in Trondheim, Norby says, oh, hi, Craig. Oh, what, you just, like, what, I bumped into you on the computer or something? Don't be pretending that you just thought of this. You sat down to write this. I'm starting a new job now and I'm really unqualified. Any advice? Yeah, get a robot. Get a robot, cuss a lot, and pretend to be Scottish.
Works for me.
This is from David in Atlanta, Georgia. You ever been down to Atlanta, Georgia there?
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Place in Georgia.
Absolutely. Oh, you can buy some time.
I should go buy some.
Great.
What do you do in your place in Atlanta, Georgia?
I hang out.
Hang out?
Oh, I'm working on my new book. Yeah.
What's it called?
It's called A Bone Alone. What? What?
What's it about?
About the bone alone.
Still working on it then, yeah?
Yeah, just started, right. Yeah.
All right. Do you know David?
Yeah, good friend.
Well, David sent an email. He says, hey, Craig, if they made a movie of your life story, who would you want to play Jeff? Ooh. Who would you want to play in the movie of our lives together, Jeff?
Boy, that's a good question.
Oh, I know who would do a very good job of you. Is that beautiful woman, what's her name? Orlando Bloom.
Awesome.
Yeah. Orlando Bloom is you and Liza Minnelli is me. Be awesome. This is from Kevin in Bailey, Colorado, who says, dear Craig, when I first started dating my girlfriend's mom, her mom hated... Sorry, I'm a bit slow and the audience is a bit quick. When I first started dating my girlfriend, her mom hated me. Now I have since fixed that, but I think her dad hates me. What should I do? Well, do what you did with her mom. And that'll clear the air one way or another. This is from Brian in Kansas City, who says, dear Craig and Jeff, my wife says I'm a flirt and it gets on her nerves. I like to socialize and don't think I cross any lines. Who is right? Your wife is right. This is from Amy in Green Bay, Wisconsin, says, dear Craig, I started watching House Hunters International and noticed that no other country in the world has shower curtains. Why is that? Because they are not prudes about sex. Look. I know we've run out of time, but I just want to very quickly give a brief history discussion here, right? Now, you know I love America. I got my tattoo. I'm a citizen, right? Now, but we are a country that was founded in a large part by Puritans, people who came away from the Middle Ages in Britain because the religious practices weren't strict enough. In Britain! In the Middle Ages! But it wasn't strict enough! I'm European, though. Can you wink?
Why do you do this to me?
Go on, give him a wink. You know.
I'm trying.
All right, and there's another email there, but we don't have time for that. So we'll be right back after these messages. back, everybody. Sorry, Jeff and I were just popping and locking there.
Oh, I need a cigarette.
Yeah. CBS cares. Not about this show, but... my first guest tonight has got his second season of Control TV. It starts streaming live on July the 1st. He's an innovator. He's something of a genius. Oh. Seth Green, everybody. Seth Green. Seth,
how you doing, man?
I'm good. You look good. You look good. Look at you. You got a suit going on and everything. Yeah. Is that mohair?
Yeah.
It's
fine mohair taken from the hair of children and the Aborigines.
Send your letters to Seth Green. Where would you like the letters to go, Seth?
Oh, directly to my parole officer.
All right. Are you on the Tweety? Are you on the Twitter retweets?
Yeah, I do a little bit of Twittery tweeting.
Oh, yeah. I should follow you. What's your Tweety handle?
It's really simple. It's Seth Green.
You know what? You want to hook something that the kids will get into? Look, I have to teach you what the kids want to see.
Yeah, that's what I try and do. No, I mean, the stuff that I tweet is either silly or informational or just for fun. You can do a lot of performance art on Twitter.
Yeah, you make the little things into like naked boobies and stuff.
No, you can just be really silly on it. If people follow your feed and someone else's feed and you guys get together and do something, so I kidnapped Zach Levi on Twitter one night.
This is a virtual kidnapping we're talking about, right?
It was, yeah, right, yeah, then. Yeah. I was outside his house and I tweeted, outside Zach Levi's house, I smell a kidnapping. And then I knocked on his door and I was like, hey, tweet that you hear strange noises.
Wait, you really were outside his house? Dude, this is bordering on illegal already.
Well, we had plans. We were getting together.
Oh, right, I see.
As I was driving up, I thought, oh, this will be funny. And then I said, hey, tell everybody that you hear strange noises. You're going to go check it out. And then we spent the night, like, he was like, I'm locked in a trunk. And I'm like, I got him.
Hey, you guys are wild.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
That's right. That's crazy.
Banksy ain't got nothing on me.
Hey. Banksy, you like Banksy? I like Banksy. Yeah.
I like street art. Yeah.
I was hoping that he was going to win the Oscar so that he would turn up and reveal his secret identity.
I don't think that would happen. He'd show up in a spacesuit or something.
Yeah. Yeah. You know who Banksy really is?
Who? I knew it.
How are you doing with being married? You still married?
Yes, yeah, still.
Wow, that's great. Well, what was that? That's a lot. I mean, because you just got married, right? The last time you were here?
We've been married a little more than a year now.
Yeah, so there you go. That's in Hollywood years, that's like 20.
20, yeah. The silver, I think. Yeah.
Still talking?
No, we still really like each other.
Oh, nice. That's great. No, that's good. And, you know, like if you were to visit this show, for example, in the audience, one of you would sit next to the other one. You wouldn't sit.
That's true.
That's how you make a marriage work, kids.
I think that's the key to it.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know, I'm just saying. So tell me about this show, the Control TV. What's that about?
Well, we're about to start the second season of it. And right. what it is it's a social experiment where a guy has volunteered to be observed 24 hours a day for 6 weeks.
On TV?
Well, it's online, so there's different regulations. But we essentially follow this guy 24 hours a day for 6 weeks. And every single thing that he does is documented. The difference between this and something like Big Brother is that the audience has a say in what he does. We were just noticing the way that with mediums like Twitter or Facebook, there's so much immediate communication and everyone has an opinion. Do you know what I mean?
Oh yeah.
Like that. Well, if you think about it, when that Alec Baldwin phone call came out, by noon everyone had heard it, and by 2 o'clock everyone had an opinion about it. So we thought, what if you could actually target that opinion to have an effect? What if you gave people
the guy would be dead in say 24 hours then?
You'd think so, but what we discovered, we give people 10 or 12 choices throughout the day that they make on behalf of this guy. Anything as simple as what does he eat to things that are complicated, like who does he date or what job does he take. And you would have thought that the audience would be more destructive, but we were really surprised.
Someone just fainted. Was that someone just fainted?
I know. It's a hot topic.
Yeah, really no, it's a hot topic. someone just went, was furiously left.
I'm so sorry. The subscription's free.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it really?
It really is, yeah.
Now, who's this guy, then? Who is he?
Well, the original guy was a guy named Tristan Kavaris, who started as a worker in an IT recruiting firm. And through the experience that we gave him, was able to meet other entrepreneurs and realize that he was not as stuck as he thought. And through the help of the audience, they made a lot of decisions on his behalf. He wound up starting his own company and hiring people that he liked to work with to work for him. So
you're like new media Oprah or something.
Well, you know, it's just an interesting thing when you're willing to turn your life over to the will of the collective, if you will.
Yeah.
How will they work on your behalf?
What if they don't like the guy? What if they say, "All right, go and you know."
Well, that's what this is about. We actually are going to have a live vote. You guys can go to the website now. It's controltv.com, and we've got the three guys that are the finalists to be chosen for the second season.
Oh, so they choose a guy.
Yeah. So the audience this time will be involved in the actual vote of who the subject is.
And when do they say? Move that bus. When did that?
I think that's in the parking lot, right?
Yeah.
Right after we get
move that bus, and then everyone cries.
Well, the crying is crucial. Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't cry.
Do you ever watch that show that Extreme Home Makeover?
Yeah, it's always very touching when you see people whose lives are.
I know. It's just like
get a new
every time I watch it, and the people that they help, I think I am such a scumball. You know, like I mean, I think that anyway.
You know, people. That's what the media says about you, Craig, but I
don't believe
that. That's not true.
Well, I am, yeah.
It's just not true.
I'm an unreliable, flaky...
They've got an agenda. That's none of that's fact.
Really?
Yeah.
It's really good to see you, man. It cheered me up. I'm worried about your guy online, though.
Are you?
Yeah, I am a little bit, because I think there's a lot of negative energy out there, too.
Well, we thought so, too, and that's why that's honestly why I wanted to get involved with this, because it's such a potentially dangerous thing. We wanted to make sure that the tone was always appropriate, and we never really give anyone too destructive of a choice. They have an A, B, or C choice, and it's usually mildly annoying as opposed to really destructive.
Kind of like this show.
A little bit.
Right. But we'll see where you go.
But what we found was that everybody was actually really interested. They got on his side by watching him exist 24 hours a day. People became really invested in him.
Do you think then that the collective has more negative energy, or that negative energy is so bleak that it stands out because the rest of it is actually quite lovely? But when you see something horrible, you go, oh, that's, and you focus on that.
It's hard as human beings not to want to see bad things just because we observe ourselves the way we'd observe zoo animals. We're really interested in ourselves as a species. But what's interesting is that through this experiment, we learned that people are more inclined to help someone than they are to go out of the way to hurt them. And we were really reassured by humanity. So thanks, guys.
Well done, humanity. All right.
Well, so the best part is that you can vote right now and pick which one of these three guys is going to be the guy.
All right. Listen, mouth organ awkward pause, or we have a new third option that's starting tonight.
Oh, let's hear it.
Mouth organ awkward pause, or touch my glittery ball.
Well, since we've already had a really successful awkward pause,
right.
And I have heard you play the mouth organ, you're quite an expert.
Thank you.
I think I'll take the road less traveled and touch your glittery ball.
Okay, well, hold on then. This is the first time we've tried it, so let's prepare it. We're using the CBS multi-million dollar stand. All right, you ready?
Yeah.
Mr. Bus Driver.
Yes.
Touch my glittery ball. Welcome back. My next guest is one of the greatest magicians in the world. He's got a documentary coming, Make Believe, which is in theaters now. Please welcome the genius that is Lance Burton, everybody. Man,
I am tweeting now.
Who are you? Are you on the Tweety? I was just talking about the thing.
I heard, and I am following Craigie Ferg.
That's me on the Tweety.
Yes.
What are you on the Tweety?
I'm Lance Burton, MM.
What does MM stand for?
Master Magician.
Oh.
And, And this morning,
yeah,
I tweeted a picture of me and a huge, huge Hollywood movie star that I met this morning.
Who? Wait, is this a trick?
No.
Okay. That's one of them. It's a monkey.
Hangover 2.
Oh, it's the monkey from Hangover 2. Oh, look at that. Oh, yeah, there you are. Hey, did it poop on your suit?
No.
Oh, all right.
No, it's a very nice monkey.
Hey, you know, the day's not done yet, buddy. You're here now.
Okay.
Hey, by the way, have you ever been to the Crazy Horse Striptease Saloon in Adelaide?
Not that I remember.
All right. Then you probably have been.
Okay.
How are things going with being off stage in Vegas? How long were you doing that show?
I was a professional magician for 30 years.
Well, you still are a professional magician.
Well, retired.
Really?
I did 15,000 shows.
Jeez.
And thank you. Yeah. But I seem to be working harder now that I'm retired. Well, for instance, I'm here all week long promoting this film, and normally when I'm on your show, I'm on your show on a Monday.
Hey, you have to be because that's
my day off.
Yeah, your day off.
But now I can be here on a Thursday or a Friday.
Yeah, no, but it's still Thursday, isn't it?
Yeah.
Depends on your region. Oh, yeah. But now tell me about the film then. What's the film about?
This film. First thing you have to understand is in Las Vegas every year there is a convention of magicians.
I would believe that.
And it is called the World Magic Seminar, and we have 1,000 magicians that descend on Las Vegas
from all over the world.
All over the world.
Right.
It's been going on for like 35 years. So
right.
The last 20 years I have been the sponsor of the youth program.
Right.
And now we have kids that fly in. Teenage magicians from America, South America, from Asia, from Europe, from Africa.
Right.
And we have a whole lectures and classes for the kids. And one of the big things in our program is the contests. So the kids come.
These are contests, so they become professional musicians.
No, magicians.
Or weirdly enough, musicians.
Musicians. See.
That's magic.
So, no, they do their magic act on stage,
right.
and we pick the best teen magician in the world.
Right.
So.
And then what do they get?
And they get a nice plaque.
That's it.
And they
nobody goes to Vegas for a plaque, right?
They get a stack of black chips.
Do they get a?
We should think about that.
Yeah, that's what you want. Not yet.
Okay.
You'll get your chance.
I'm just seeing it is.
No, right. You'll get your chance. Okay. Now just relax. Relax. So you pick the best young teen magician in the world, and then you send them off to Hogwarts.
Exactly.
Right.
Okay. So these documentary filmmakers came around a couple of years ago, and the director is this really fine director, Clay Tweel, and the producer was Stephen Klein, and they wanted to make a documentary about young people doing magic. So they picked six of these kids.
And they follow them.
They follow them around.
Oh, nice.
And some are from America, from California, from Denver, from Chicago. There's a kid from Japan.
Now, do you narrate the movie?
No.
Morgan Freeman narrates the movie.
I play. Yes.
I know they're all the magicians. Jeff, do you know anything about that? You've narrated movies, haven't you?
Oh yeah, I do a killer Morgan Freeman.
No, let's hear it. Listen to this Morgan Freeman. It's very good.
I remember a long time ago.
Isn't that good? Now that's magic, Lance. That's magic right there.
We may have to re-edit the film.
Nah, you're all right. Listen, do you still perform at all? Even are you completely like you've got nothing up your sleeve anymore?
I always have something up my sleeve.
Right, right.
Magician.
Right.
You want to see a trick?
Yeah, an illusion. There you go.
One for you.
Yeah?
I'll do it for you?
Yeah.
Then I'll do one for the people.
Yeah, okay. Okay. Whatever. Yeah, I consider myself one of the people.
You're one of the people. Yeah. Okay. Then you will be their representative.
Yes, all right.
I know you like card tricks I've done on the show.
Yeah, very much.
Now, if you can just hold both hands out like this and make a little table about 6 to 8 inches above the... Perfect.
Right.
I just want you to hold that for me. Perfect.
Right.
Now, I want you to imagine that these four cards are the four walls to your house. Now, if I were to ask you what was on the walls,
yeah,
I'll bet you could tell me. But if I ask you what was on the ceiling of your house, what would you say?
Beams?
And maybe on the beams were a few...
Spider webs.
Well, I'm not saying you're a bad housekeeper or anything. I'm just, you know, that happens. Now, we want to get rid of the spider webs.
Right.
Now, you know how to do that, don't you?
Take dust.
Dust?
Yeah.
This is the magic way. Take this hand
right,
and slowly wave it over the cards.
Will I say something magic?
You can make a magic noise if you want. Yeah.
Okay, I'm done.
All right, very good. Yeah. All right. That's, now let's see. Yes.
Wow.
Spiderwebs are gone.
Wow. Look at that.
But now you know where you have spider webs. You have
spiders.
Now we want to get rid of the spiders.
Yes.
But we don't want to use chemicals. That's bad for the environment.
Yes.
So you know how to make the spiders disappear. Slowly wave both hands over the cards. Both hands.
Magic noise. I'm pretty good.
You okay?
Yeah, I'm all right.
Okay.
Can we add in a deeper scream when I see this man? Hey, we're out of time. Now, listen, mouth organ, awkward pause, or touch my magic glittery ball?
We did awkward pause last time.
We did.
Let's try mouth organ.
Mouth organ it is. There you are.
Okay.
This is mine.
Okay.
This is yours. Ah! There you go. Yeah. All right. Can you play? Because you know you can win the golden mouth organ if you can play.
Can I? Oh, really?
Yeah.
Really? Yeah.
It doesn't look to me like you can.
Okay. Let's...
Ready? It's good, but no golden mouth organ. Let's Burton, everybody!
You know, we used to just have kids from America. Now they're coming from Europe, they're coming from Asia. We had a huge contingent from South Africa. It amazes me how diverse the backgrounds of the kids are.
I mean, you're gonna see the best in the world, the best teens, the best magician. You're gonna see Jeff McBride, Eugene Berger, Lance Burton, Chris Angel. And then you're gonna see people like Kristen Lambert, Bill Cook, and all those people. So you're learning from the best, and you're with the best people in the business.
If you're going to be in the L.A. area and would like to attend a taping of The Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson, please call 323-570-0059.
What did we learn on the show tonight, Craig?
Meow.
We learned that when you see a spider, sometimes a grown man sounds like a little girl. Good night, everybody.